What's up, guys? Welcome back to Sim Park Observer. This is Jason, and today we are going to play Phase 3 of the Planet Coaster Alpha, which was released last Tuesday. It's been a while since I've actually posted anything, sorry about that, but I've had a chance to actually play a lot of the things that are available in the Phase 3 Alpha now, and it is a lot of fun, and I feel pretty comfortable about being able to share all the things that are new and the observations that I've had since I've had a chance to actually build a park and play with them. The first thing that you're actually going to see here on the main menu is a updated globe that's got a bunch of people standing around it, and they've all got their little hats on here, and these are all members of the community, which I believe once we get closer to the beta and the full game release will expand more around this globe. Right now there's not a lot of people. There's me right there in the United States in California, that's where I am, and a list of all the people that are on the world are over here. I believe most of these people are YouTube stars, and they're all listed as being celebrities. I think there might be some people here from Frontier, but I'm not 100% sure. These people actually have items uploaded to the Steam Workshop as far as blueprints are concerned. It could be a building, a facility, it could be a particular type of coaster or some scenery. It could be a bunch of different things. But if you click each person's name, you get an idea of what they have available to share on the Steam workshop. Sorry, it was blank in there for a second. If you want to subscribe to any of these items and download them into your park itself, all you have to do is find something you like. Like, say I like this Wild West Saloon. I'm going to go ahead and hit subscribe to that. And now when I go into play, it's going to actually be available in my blueprints to play in whatever park I want to. So that gives you an idea. You can actually access them over here in this list. Or again, if you close that out and go back out to the world, you can actually just choose them based on clicking the person and seeing what they have available. This is not the first menu you're going to see when you first launch Alpha 3, Phase 3 for the first time. You're actually going to see an option to create and edit your avatar. This is the guy that I've got created here, but you're going to see over here you've got options to change him from male to female, adult to teen, and regular to large. Those are your different body types and genders. You can choose to randomize a character any way you want. You also have options here for skin, heads, hair. You're going to see that there's really not a whole lot of selections available now. I'm assuming that this might actually grow when we get closer to the beta. Oop, there's a little glitch with his pants there. Or even to the final release. These are the pants and these are the hats. The hats, of course, are the hats that are available from the Hats Fantastic store inside the game. I thought that's kind of a cool choice. But you get the idea of how you can actually custom create your avatar. One final note, guys, before we drop into an actual game here to show you the new items. The Alpha, or the Early Bird Edition, is no longer available for sale on the Frontier store or even on the Steam store. You can go to the Steam store to buy this game, but the only thing it's going to let you do is give you access to the beta, which they haven't set a date for yet. And if anything, at least the full version of the game, which actually comes out on November 17th. So if you haven't done so and you're having any doubts about whether or not you want to buy this game, let me just erase those right off the bat, because this game is totally, totally worth it. Go out and buy it. I highly, highly recommend. Watch all the videos that are on YouTube. You'll see what I mean. Okay, so here you can see in this menu, we can either resume the last game that was saved. Here I have an autosave, which I don't want to jump into yet. But this is like a quick jump into the last park that you had. Whether you save the game or it autosaved, you can just click that and jump right in. Or you can go to the play option here, where you have a few new options. You've got the career, which is coming soon, not available yet. The sandbox, which we are all used to, and we'll show that in just a little bit. Actually, I'll show it to you now. Tropical and desert are the two available right now. Grassland, alpine, and decadus are coming soon, not available just yet. I'm going to go back here to show the other options available. You can actually select a challenge. There's not actually individual challenges yet. It says it's a work in progress. It just basically sets your money from being infinite to a limited amount of funds, and you actually have to maintain a park with those funds by buying things to keep your guests happy, maintaining your staff, and things like that. Down here you have My Parks. This is where all your save parks are going to be located. And tutorials and what's new is coming soon. So I'm going to go ahead and go into this little park that I've created to show you guys what is new in Alpha Phase 3. And once again, the load times on this thing, very, very short. You're not going to actually see that wheel spinning for very long before you jump right into the park. And we have a lot to cover today, guys, so I will really try to do my best to Keep it short, sweet, simple, just to kind of give you the details and show you as many of the new items as we can. I don't know if I'll be able to cover everything, but I'm going to do my darndest. Okay, so the way we're going to do this is we're actually going to cover the territory from left to right, down here at the bottom all the way over to the right. At first, you're going to see this little dotted line around where your avatar would normally be, and I'm going to pause this so we can actually hold the sunlight for now. I was hoping that we'd actually have our avatar picture here in this circle. Doesn't appear that that's available yet. I haven't checked the settings to see if that's maybe something that I can actually change later, but for now it doesn't seem to be available, and I was kind of disappointed in that because I wanted to see my little face right there, but maybe it'll be in an update coming soon. We'll see. Instead of actually complaining and whining about that, we're going to go straight into Park Management. That's the first tab available, and you're going to be able to see a couple of tabs that are available right now for Hire Staff and Staff List. Finance, Guests, and Park Operations are yet to come. I'm sure those will be available probably during the beta or maybe even during the full release. But for now, all we have is Entertainers and Maintenance. You guys have actually seen Chief Beef, you've seen Gulpy Rex, King Coaster, and also Captain Lockjaw, but these two characters are new. Cosmic Cow and also Princess Amelie, I think, or Amelia, maybe? I'm not really sure how that's pronounced. But anyway, we're going to go ahead and select them and drop them into our park. He's a little turned around there, but that's okay. And we'll also go ahead and select the princess and drop her in. I'm going to go ahead and hit play so you guys can see their animations really quick. And you can see the Cosmic Cow's bouncing around, the princess is waving, and let me pause it really quick to kind of show you guys the options that comes up when you drop your new staff members into the park. Now you can actually see here in this window some brief information about them, what kind of job title they have, what their status is, monthly tasks, guests entertain, and recent thoughts. Now those thoughts are going to pop up when you actually have peeps in your park, and you're going to be able to find out if they're happy, if they're sad, if they want more money, if they need more training, and if they need either one of those, you have these two tabs here for employment where you can actually increase their salary, or you can actually up their training level as well, but only until you reach a certain point in the game timeline. So right now, if you go down here to this little area, it says we're at May 7th on year 3, but I'm not going to be able to train her again until June 7th. So that gives you an idea of how much time you're going to have to wait, and it'll go by quicker than you think. It's not like a full month or even a day in real time. It's just minutes. So have patience if it's not available yet. Just keep doing other stuff, and eventually it'll become available. You just have to remember to come back. The other buttons down here are the staff camera, where it actually zooms in on the person that you actually want to see. It automatically starts with cinematic, which if you leave it on here long enough, it will change even in the paused mode. You see it just flipped over there. Or you can actually go to the interest mode, and from here, follow them no matter where they're moving, and you can even rotate the camera around to kind of get a better perspective from the front, side, behind, whatever you want to do. Hit escape to get out of this, and that's basically it. Park management, again, that was for higher staff. The newer maintenance person you have is the janitor. This guy's going to be really, really helpful because you now have some rides that are going to make your people sick, and they are also going to be very messy with the litter in your park, and they're going to dump stuff on the sidewalk, and they're going to get sick from all those intense rides that you build. So this guy, you might want to hire a few of him to help clean up your park, because there's going to be some messes on the sidewalk once you get those peeps in there. Same options over here. I'm not going to go over those again, but you get an idea of what his helpfulness to your park is going to be like. One final thing in the park management, the staff list. This is just basically where you have a list of entertainers, janitors, and vendors. The vendors are basically just the people that are actually going to be working in the stalls that you create, such as first aid, or actually not first aid. I think it's more like the food, drink, souvenir stores like the Hat's Fantastic Place. These people are under the same influences as these people, so if you actually if they feel like they're underpaid, they're going to let you know. If they need more training, they're going to let you know that as well. So keep that in mind when you're actually trying to keep all of your staff happy. So I'm going to go ahead and close this out for now, and that concludes it for park management. And we're going to go right over here to My Blueprints. Now, I told you earlier when you actually saw that globe and all those people around that you can actually download people's blueprints from the Steam network, or the Steam Workshop, that is. You can also create your own blueprints and upload them to the Steam Workshop as well. And they'll also be saved in your inventory items here for download in a future park. Like for this one right here, Information Booth, this is actually something that I built. It's very easy just to click on it and rotate it around. and connect it to a path. Super simple, and it's already pre-built because you took care of it earlier and you saved it as a blueprint. And I mean, I liked it. I thought it was very handy and, you know, kind of generic. So if you just need a generic information booth that happens to fit this space, it's a perfect way to just save it and place it in other parks. You can also do the same thing for scenery and building types. I created this fence just sort of out of a few generic pieces. You can just click it there and then just go back in and click it again and create sort of like a border around your paths, if you like. I've seen a lot of people do this on YouTube. I would like to eventually kind of create different types of fences so I can actually have different borders around my paths. It's something that I wish that they would add automatically and snap to the path, but it's not available yet. They just give us these kind of things as options to do it on our own if we want. Blueprints not only covers buildings and scenery items, but it also covers coasters as well. If you have any blueprints saved, you're going to be able to see them here. Right now we don't see it in this immediate area, but when we get to the coasters later, you are going to see some blueprints saved. The menu options over here have changed too, guys. You can remember this was not even available before. It was just one large list of items. But now you can actually categorize things by individual stuff. And if you just hover over it, it'll tell you what those items are. This one is for coasters. This one's for shops, scenery, and buildings, etc. So you're going to see when we go into these other tabs, these will change based on the tab that you selected for coasters, rides, shops, and facilities, etc. You'll see what we mean when we go along. That's about it for the blueprints for now. We're going to go ahead and move on over to the coasters. And I think this one we have the most to cover. And I've actually got some things sort of pre-built over in this area to show you some of the new coasters that are available and also show you some details that have been added to the existing ones. So some of the new ones available, I'm going to go ahead and show you that there's the blueprints. These are, I think, were already built for in-game. If you wanted to select a coaster rather than having to build one on your own, it's very easy. Just find an empty spot in your park. Click on a blueprint, and then you see it's right here. You just left click and drop it in. I don't really have a good spot for this right now unless I rotate it. I guess maybe I could drop that in there. Let's see if that works. Yep, boom, done. So it's that easy, guys. If you have your own coaster like this one that I built here and you want to save it as a blueprint, it's very simple. All you do is just go over here to this option once the window's open and selected and click save as blueprint. And then follow the steps here to add a new blueprint. It's very, very simple and so user-friendly. Anybody can do it. All right, so back to the new coasters here. Let's go back to the coasters tab. We're going to click custom so we can see all the types. And again, you have subcategories here for steel coasters and wooden coasters. Wooden coasters, obviously not out yet. Just the steel ones available. I believe the wooden will be available either in the beta or the full release. That's pretty much the only options we have because I don't think there's going to be anything else in between. So this is one of the new ones right here, guys. This is actually called the Launched Torque. And I think I've been on a ride like this before at Six Flags Magic Mountain in California. That's the state that I live in. And it's called, I think, Full Throttle. And it's really cool because it launches out of the station, goes into this gigantic loop, and then midway through the track, it actually hits a brake station, launches you backwards, goes up a hill, and then launches you forward up and over that gigantic loop that you created in the beginning. If you do some searches for it on YouTube, you'll probably see what I'm talking about. It's really a lot of fun to ride, and I can't wait to actually build my own. One of the other things that's new, guys, is you're going to see in all these coasters that we're looking at, we actually have ride operators now. And you can see they've added a ton of detail to these booths, and I'm going to go ahead and hit play so you guys can see the animation of the operators that are pushing the buttons. They're checking around to make sure that the ride is operating well, the trains are coming in, and I think eventually she's going to go ahead and sort of tap that microphone just to make sure that everything's working and maybe make an announcement, but we don't hear anything. They don't have voices here. But just check out all the detail. There's like water bottles here, things taped up in the windows. There's like a little safety manual here. There's paperwork that I'm sure she's probably got to file. And even over here, I mean, this is how much detail we can get into. Look at this. I'm going to zoom in on this, and it actually says Planet Coaster Ticket Booth of the Year. So she actually got like a little certification award and was able to stick it in her little booth there. So I think that's really cool and really detailed. I really love watching this kind of stuff that they add to the realism and detail of this game. It's just phenomenal. We're going to go ahead and move over here to the next new one. This one is called the Fourth Dimension Test Pilot. Again, there's another one at Six Flags Magic Mountain like this called X2. And when you build this coaster, it's very similar to the real thing, where you can actually make these seats rotate 360 degrees any part on the track that you want to. There's actually a new icon that's been added when you put new piece of track on there, and I'm going to show you that really quick. Let me go to the end. Oops. Whoa. Let's undo that. I'm not sure. I think I went a little bit too fast there. Okay. So let's go back in here and we'll edit. And I just got to give it a little second there. Okay, there we go. So this is right here where the seats, you can actually click to rotate the trains, or rather the seats on the train, in any direction you want to. It works similar to these ones, where you just click and hold and move left or right, and you can change the angle at which the seats rotate on that particular piece of track. It might take a little getting used to, but you'll see what I mean once you start building it. It's actually going to be probably very, very easy to build. Okay, so moving right along, back onto the new coasters again. Let me find out what this one is called, because these are the ones that I'm not really familiar with, because I've never actually ridden them before, just seen videos on the internet about. This one is called, I think, the, no, that's not the Junior Wendigo. This is the, I think this one is the El Loco Looney Turns, and you're going to notice that the track is very similar to sort of like the Junior coaster, but you're going to be able to actually build some crazy inversions with such a short, compact little train. It is literally just these two rows of seats, and that's it. When you build coasters like this and the Eurofighter that we're going to show you next, my recommendation to you guys is build block break sections so you can actually have multiple trains. They did enable that in the coaster editor, and you will be able to have multiple trains for your roller coaster. So I would highly, highly, highly recommend it. And we'll go over that, how to do that in just a little bit. I'll show you guys like a little trick on how to actually get those multiple trains to show up. This is the Eurofighter. This is very similar to the Looney Turns that we saw earlier. Again, not really sure you know, what type of coaster this represents, like other ones. I've seen other ones around on videos and such like that, but you know, fun to build, compact, but again, block brakes so you can get multiple trains. Otherwise, if you only have one train running on a really long track, you're going to have a really long queue line, and you don't want your guests getting angry because they're waiting forever. I think that's about it for the new ones. These ones right here and also right here are not new. There might be some new design per se in the style of it and the color, but for the most part, nothing has changed in them except for some animations in the station itself. So I'm going to go ahead and click on this to show you guys the detail that they've put into this. You'll notice before that they actually didn't have anything here in the middle. There was no platform, and the peeps, when they walked out, just popped right into the seats. I don't know if they actually walk onto the seats now, but you can actually see that there is a corrugated metal platform down below here. And when I actually go to test this train, and I unpause the game, watch what happens. That's not supposed to happen. This is what's supposed to happen. The strains go up, and the platform goes down, the gates go open. It's actually just like the real thing. And it's not only animated up there, but if you look down below here, just to give you another idea of the level of detail and time and effort they put into making this thing look very realistic, the hydraulics actually do work like real hydraulics. Look at that. That is just incredible. So very happy to see this kind of an update, even though it's the same train as before. I really do like seeing that much more detail added into this, because they thought about this for a really long time. Same thing is for this inverted coaster over here. If I go ahead and select this one, and I go to unpause it and start the test, you're gonna see it glitches here for a second, but then the restraints go up and then down, and the platform lowers, the gate goes down, and then the train will eventually dispatch. I don't have a track out here, so that's why it's not going anywhere, but you guys get the idea. There are a couple other trains and coasters that actually work the same way with these platforms. You guys take your time to look at it and just kind of marvel in the detail that they did on this. It's really fantastic. And even the details that they've added to the cars, yes, of course, they look cell shaded and painted, and you know, it does look like a video game, but even for that, it still looks really detailed and awesome. You know what, I wonder if even these, if the hydraulics go up when you actually lift the restraints up. Let's see right here. No, they don't do that, but that's okay. minute details, don't care about them, but then at the same time, it's neat to see when they actually do add them. All right, so really quick, we're going to go over the options that are available now in the Coaster Designer. The first tab here is your checklist. That's where you place your entrance and exit, etc. You also have your ability to save a blueprint, edit your track, start building on station grid. This is when you want to add walls and panels and stuff like that to make your station house look nice. This is your ride camera. If you want to move the ride, this is the option, and then if you want to demolish it. Your overview tab gives you an idea of the type of roller coaster it is, the guest thoughts, so you can adjust your ride accordingly to make everybody happy, and some general ride statistics. And speaking of statistics, when you go into the testing tab now, when you test out your coaster, you have two options. You've got live data, and you've also got the results. The live data is actually going to show you the excitement, fear, and nausea, and speed as the coaster is going around the track real time. So if it's going up a hill, these numbers are going to be low. If it's coming down a hill and into a loop, these numbers are going to start increasing based on the amount of G-forces they're feeling, the amount of excitement they're experiencing going into an inversion, etc. Once the track is completed and the circuit is completed on the track, you're going to get a total number of results here for excitement, fear, and nausea. These are the ones that you used to see in Roller Coaster Tycoon 3, and the higher the excitement, the better. Fear, probably not a bad idea to have it at a low number as well. Nausea, you definitely want very, very low, as low as you can get. Otherwise, people are going to get sick, they're not going to want to ride it, and you're going to have a big mess in your park. So you also got a lot more details in here as far as duration, length, max speed, average. These are all things that they usually report on for real coasters, and I think that's awesome that they actually added those extra details. Over here in your finances tab is where you can actually set your ticket price and see all the income statistics. Here is where you have your customized tab. You actually have the ability now to change the color of your trains as well as your track and supports. And this is where you would actually change them. The track color right here, I believe, is where the rails are. This is where the sort of cross beams are between the rails. The third one here, I believe, is your I-beam. It's that big solid beam below your track. And this one right here is the supports. The car color varies based on what type of train you have, but you get the idea. Just change black to whatever color you want. There's a big palette of colors. If you don't like the way it is, you can just reset it to the defaults and go from there. Here is where you can also move your entrance and your exit. One final thing that I wanted to touch on in this final tab in the operations, this is where you can add your multiple trains if you have your block break section enabled. And I'm going to show you that coaster that I built that has multiple trains in just a second. This is also where you can set your load rules if you want to wait for a half a load, a full load, etc. That's where you can set those. And this is also where you can actually enable a new priority pass. The priority pass is very similar to other fast passes that they have, like at Disneyland. I want to say Six Flags has the Flash Pass, and there are other parks around the country that have similar concepts. They just call them something different, but here it's called the priority pass. I have a priority pass set up on another ride on the other side of this park, but we'll get to that in a little while to kind of show you guys an idea of what that looks like and how it works. But for now, that's the end of the coaster window descriptive. I'm gonna go ahead and close that out, and we're gonna go over here to this little junior coaster that I created. And you can see it's a very simple design. I didn't want to make anything too crazy or complex. We've got our standard lift hill, we've got some gravity that just takes it down here, and then I've got my first block break added here. Now one block break is not enough. It does not identify the lift hill or the station as a block break section. You actually have to put one more on top of that. So this is the first one, and then the second one, where it would technically get held until the other train clears a station, is right over here. I want to say it's, yeah, this section right here. So once you have both of those block breaks enabled and you do your test, you can actually add another train to your track. If you add another block break section away from this somewhere else, you could even add a third one, but it's kind of tricky. You don't want your trains getting all backed up and running into each other, so you have to be careful about where you place them. Let me unpause the game so you guys can actually see that it does work, and it works really well actually when you get them placed in the right area. So that one's hit that block break section, and now it launches that one. And because this one had already realized that had left the station, it went, And it's just going to keep going in that continuous circuit. And again, the reason that you want this is because it's going to keep your lines moving a lot faster, and your people will be very, very happy. Your guests will be happy because they're not standing in these really, really long lines. So that gives you an idea of how the block break system works. Very brief and general overview. And that's pretty much it for the coasters, guys. Let's go ahead and move over to the rides. Again, we have categories under all. Thrill rides, gentle rides, and eventually transport rides, not available yet. But if you guys have seen the same video I have, there's going to be at least a train that I know of. It looks very similar to the trains that they have that go around the Disneyland parks. Very sort of Victorian style, steam engine, very cool with, I think they have front facing and also side facing seats. So we're going to see that, but just not yet. Again, beta or full release in November. But for now, we're going to go ahead and just kind of showcase some of the new ones that they have available. Under the thrill rides category, we've got two new ones available. This Gears of Fear, which I've actually placed an example of right here, and it's in the middle of testing, so you guys get an idea of how it works. And it's really cool. It's got a lot of great animations. The gears work. The smoke comes out of the stacks. I think there's even flames that come out of them every once in a while. And, of course, the arms go up, and the car here, if you will, or this bar of chairs flips around upside down, and I want to say that these bars or these arms actually even go in different directions, so it kind of creates sort of like an angular rotation eventually as well. And it might do that just a second here. Let's give it a second to see what it looks like. Come on, there we go. Yep, definitely a ride that I would not be going on anytime soon. There's the flames. Really cool animation. I think it's even got some kind of like music that it plays. Very industrious sort of like steampunkish. So that's that new one. Very simple, but also very thrilling, and probably has a very high nausea rating. In fact, let's take a look at that really quick. I'm kind of curious to see what it has. Yeah, excitement 5.5, fear 5.6, and nausea 4.6. It's actually not as bad as I thought, but it's still higher than any coaster that I've ever created, and certainly wouldn't want to go on it myself. The next new one over here we got is called the Cube. This one's kind of freaky because it's got actually rings within rings. I've seen astronauts do smaller versions of this where they train for artificial gravity and how to control themselves within that environment. This is something similar that they just attached a bunch of chairs to, similar to the Gears of Fear over here. And all these rings rotate within each other, so you go in all sorts of crazy directions. The excitement, fear, and nausea rating for this definitely higher than the Gears of Fear. Gosh, I almost think that this one should be called Gears of Fear because it's got even a higher rating, but again, something that you would just not catch me dead on. Well, maybe you would catch me dead because I'd go on it alive and then die in the middle of it from, you know, passing out. But anyway, you get the idea. That's the next thrilling ride available. And the final ride that's actually new are a very similar feature here that you've probably seen at Disney World and also Disneyland is the teacups. Very gentle ride, probably a little bit nauseating here. Oh, actually, not too bad, only 1.8. But a decent excitement and fear rating, and probably something that's going to be very, very popular. Over here, I've actually set a priority pass based on what you can actually do to make your guests go through your lines a lot quicker. Now, you can see that I've actually already got a main queue line here that's kind of long, and it goes from here all the way around here and over to here. Well, anybody who actually buys a priority pass within your park, which you will actually need to make sure that you have an information booth available for people to buy those priority passes. It won't work if it's not in there. But anybody who buys it can actually access the priority passes for your rides. They would normally just go through this main entrance, and instead of going through the long queue, go through the short queue and skip the long line to get closer to the front of the ride. So very similar to how you've probably seen fast passes and flash passes and things like that work, and very nice addition. It's something that I think they just kind of sprung on us. I don't even actually think we knew that this was coming until Phase 3 was released, and then they're like, surprise, here it is. So I'm pleasantly surprised. It's a really great feature, and I can't wait to actually use it in more rides. So that's it for the new riots, guys. All the options over here in the window are very similar to the ones you've seen in the coaster. You've got your overview, your testing, finances, customize, because you can change the color in these as well, and also your operations. The operations are probably going to be a little bit different than the coasters because you're not going to be able to add or remove trains, but you can choose the waiting times for them and also enable or disable your priority pass. I haven't been able to figure out what this priority over queue is. Something I'll probably have to look up on the forums to figure out, but we'll deal with that some other time. So that covers the rides. Let's go over to shops and facilities. I actually have a couple of new shops placed over here. They've only added two more, but they've actually changed some features in the main menu. Before, there used to be a bunch of the same facilities down here with different facades and textures added to them, like one would be brick, one would be stucco, the other one would be stone, etc. Instead of that now, for each one, I'm going to go to the custom one so you guys can see. For each one now, we only have one option. Like, there's only one premium food shop, and they have this sort of like generic sort of brick looking thing on the end or on the outside that you really can't change. And the reason that they have it set up that way is because they let you design around it to make it your own. So basically, instead of actually having pre-designed textures on the outside, they just leave it sort of generic so you can build on your own. So really quick, I'm going to show you the new ones available. This is the same ones that we've had before for food, drink, and gift. We've also had restrooms before, but now we have first aid, which I've actually placed right over here. It's kind of hard to see because it's just a dark door, but you can actually see that little thing on the wall with the cross on it, indicating that it is a first aid station. I'm assuming that this is going to be something that your guests will use in case they get like really sick or if they've injured themselves in the park somehow. I don't know how or why they would do that, but you get the idea. We've also got an ATM that we can place in the park. If the people are running out of money to spend on your rides, this is where they would come. And you can actually click on the guests now while they're getting money out of the ATM, and you can actually see the amount of money that has increased in their pocket once they leave the ATM, and you know, how much they've spent in the park and other statistics like that. It's a really great new feature, and this helps them spend more money in your park, which you definitely want. So I'd recommend placing a few of these around your park. And then the final one that's new, which I was mentioning earlier, is the information booth. This one basically is the place where they sell the what you call it, the priority passes, and those you can actually increase or decrease the price here, and they have, of course, have a finances tab where you can find out how well your shop is operating. If you actually select the building here, it pops up the building window that you can actually go into edit, and it creates your little grid, and you'll see that this building actually fits sort of like on the inner diameter of one of these squares on your blueprint grid. And that's so basically you can go over here to the custom tab, which pops open your building information, and you can now select a category based on what you want to add to it. Like, I selected walls, and in the walls category you have subcategories for wall pieces, arches, columns, framework, etc., based on the type that you selected. And you just select your piece, and let's say I want to add sort of like a brick facade to this. I just pop it in here, place the piece, and then I can go to my other taller pieces and just complete building this little thing. I'm not going to make it anything too complex here because we don't want to spend a whole lot of time on this video. It's going to be long enough as it is, but this will just give you an idea of how you go in and modify those buildings. And now we've got a nice little brick building for our shop there. It's very generic, but again, on these pieces now, I believe, let's see, this one, it doesn't look like we can recolor it, but I think there are some that you are able to. Let me go ahead and try this. And if I do that and go over, oops, let's close that out and select it. Yep. So this castle wall right here, you can actually recolor, and it gives you actually three different things you can recolor because it has a certain mesh or pattern of bricks that actually changes based on your selection. So let's say I want some bricks to change to yellow, and we'll leave one gray, and we'll change the other one to maybe sort of like a brown color. Oh, that's more red than anything else. Let's go down here. Yeah, it's still red. I don't even know where the brown would be. That's better. That looks good. So there you get an idea that the recoloring not only works on your rides, but it also works on your building materials that have a lot of new options based on the fairy tale theme that's been added. And I think they've even added a few more beyond that. So since we're over here and we've actually kind of finished up on the shops, I'm going to kind of just continue the building section, even though it's not quite all the way from left to right. Since we're already here, might as well go ahead and finish it. It's pretty much the same layout and design, and the rotation tools are the same as what you used before. The only difference now, when you do any scenery items that you're placing down for the first time, there is actually going to be a new option, and I'll show you in just a second here. We'll go over that later. Sorry, I'm kind of jumping ahead of myself. We'll go back in and edit this building really quick. And just to show you that it's got pretty much the same options as it had before, but except we have these categories and subcategories based on which one you choose. We showed you walls earlier, the roofs, you can show all. You can show pitched roofs, flat roofs, roof trims, roof decorations. Each one has its own category. So, another thing you can actually do to kind of narrow down those categories, if you're looking for something more specific, like say we're going into walls and we're doing a fairy tale theme and we want to filter it just by fairy tale items only. Well, I'll select the wall pieces, and then over here we've got this filter by group, and we have a bunch of different options. If you click scenery theme, I can choose fairy tale, give it a second to load, and it'll pop in the fairy tale items only. If it just, oh, you know what? Maybe there isn't any for that one. I'll be darned. I wonder why that is. No fairy tale walls, huh? I find that very... I'm in columns right now, that's why. No? All? Okay, well, there's the all. So there you get an idea of the fairy tale items they have available. I guess the walls fall under different categories, but there are some fairy tale items there. There's some fairy tale roof items. There's some fairy tale doors and windows. Even here you can actually select doors, windows individually, and window decorations, which doesn't seem that there are any. But you guys get an idea of the way you can actually categorize all these things by filters. You can even choose it by material. You can choose it by a building set, modern, castle, or rustic, and you can even choose it by nature region. So that just gives you guys an idea. Those type of tools in the building and also the scenery tab help you put things in your park a lot faster, and it's just a lot easier to find the things that you need from now on. So that pretty much covers the shops and facilities and also the buildings. The only other thing that we really want to cover is scenery and then a couple over items on the right here, and we will be done. So let's go over here and head on to the back, where I've got some new scenery items ready to look at, because they've actually created a new theme for Fairy Tale, like we were showing earlier in the building items. And here I've pretty much got almost every new fairy tale item available, sort of showing you guys what they look like. I'm going to go ahead and unpause it, because there are not only static items, but there are actually animated items in here as well, as you can see. We've got a cauldron here that's sort of got some mist or, you know, steam coming out of it. We've got some new dragons that are just absolutely amazing, great animations. We've got some statues that actually have sort of fountain qualities. They've got a juggler here where the water kind of goes back and forth in his hand. Over here, speaking of steam earlier, you've also got a big pile of dragon poop. You see steam coming out of it. You've got old pieces of chewed up knights in there, their boots, their helmets, bones. And if you actually zoom in even close enough, you can see flies buzzing around it. And I'm talking over it right now. If I'm quiet for a second, take a listen. Turn up your speakers a bit. If you actually heard that, yes, that is the sound of flies buzzing around it too. So again, the level of detail they've included on these things is just phenomenal. Here you've got some new animatronics. You've got a witch casting spells. You got a few knights. This flying witch, I've added her to my parks before, and she doesn't do anything right now. Even though they have her under the animatronics section, she's broken. She doesn't fly. She doesn't do anything. So my recommendation, don't use her. She's she's useless right now. I'm going to fast forward here so we can get kind of close back to the daytime here. It's hard to see this thing in the dark, but it is kind of neat to see how everything is affected as far as lighting, because they have made some lighting improvements. I'm going to go ahead and pause the video right here because my dogs are freaking out, and I will be right back. Okay, guys, we're back. Thanks for sticking around. We've sped up time a little bit to get the daylight back, and we're going to finish taking a look at these fairy tale items here. You can see we've got a lot of new fountain bases and fountains themselves. We've got a little water trough with, I think it's funny, this is a water trough, but it actually doesn't have water coming out of it, and it's kind of small to add a water effect coming out of it, but still a neat little decoration. And then you've got these little water fountains that have the water pipes coming out of them. There's a lot of vases, a lot of pillars, some really cool looking tents back here, some really awesome looking scary trees. Reminds me a lot of Snow White when she was going for the spooky forest and they had the trees with the faces on them. Some really old, mangled up, beaten looking trees here, and I think there's even one more over here. It doesn't have a face on it, but it's still along the same theme. We've got some other animated items. We've got a windmill. That windmill is actually an individual piece. You can place it wherever you want to, so if I click that to move it, I can separate it from the building and put it anywhere I want to. It'd be interesting to see what kind of creations people come up with to use that as an animated piece. I got these shacks back here, which I've seen in certain videos. People have actually put the sleeping dragon in there. You've got the witch's house, which I know we've actually seen on pictures posted by Frontier before. Oh, what I didn't see before is that neat little escape hatch down there. I think that's meant to be put up in a tree. Perhaps even this tree. I think that's what it's supposed to fit on top of. And then finally down here, we've got our little tree of life, who has a very pleasant, actually kind of stoned-looking face, some T-Rex arms, and these dangly lights hanging from the tree that do actually look pretty good at night, but that'll be for another time to show. We're going to go ahead and pause it here and jump right back over to the beginning of where all these scenery items are. And I wanted to show you guys something that is a little bit new with the scenery items and any objects that you place in your game. When you select your item, you can actually choose to move it around, and it actually gives you, let's see, where is it? Don't make a liar out of me, guys. Here we go. If you choose the multi-directional tool to reposition your item, you can choose this little radius of options here. You can either reset the position, you can rotate it, you can use the world axis, you can surface move it, or you can just decide to cancel or click the check mark to confirm where you want it. So that's a nice little item. Instead of actually using the hotkeys or hitting the enter key or any of your mouse button keys, you can actually use those instead. So that's a neat little feature that's been added to placing scenery items down. Along with the new scenery items, we also have these path extras here, which we've been waiting for a very long time, specifically in the neighborhood of benches and also waste bins. There's three different types of each right now. We've got a barrel bench, we've got a park bench, and also a village bench heart. I think these ones are more fairy tale themed, these ones are planet coaster sort of generic themed, and then these ones are probably like piratey, or you can probably even use it to theme yourself for the Old West. You've also got garbage bins, and this is what the janitor will actually come over with his broom, and he'll stuff his broom in the garbage to compact it, and he'll also come by and empty them. We've also got the so those are the barrels for the Western or pirate theme. We've got the planet coaster bins here, and then over here we've got the fantasy bins. I'm not sure how you feel about those. Those are kind of weird looking, but it's really well themed regardless of how you look at it. Oh, and I forgot about these little guys over here. There's one more set. This is again fantasy or fairy tale themed. Pick which one you like, place them around your park, make sure that you have them close to where all your peeps gather around, especially where they have food and stuff like that, because they will litter on your park and make it a mess. So that's it for pretty much all the regular scenery items. The only other thing that I want to cover in this area is the new rocks and trees and bushes that they actually have, and I've laid out some of the new ones that I think are new, at least. The rocks definitely go around with this new desert theme, and they blend in with this new terrain really, really awesome. I can already see people building something like, you know, Splash Mountain or Big Thunder Mountain Railroad. Those are going to be some really great park creations. We've got these new hedges and topiaries that you can actually put in your park. From a distance, they don't look like much, but when you actually get close, you can see there's a lot of detail in the leaves. And it really makes a really good little entrance here, or just some general decorations. This one I tend to use the most because you can actually put it around a path and make it sort of like a path border. Instead of putting a fence, you can put a hedge, and it separates the people from the path and whatever is on the other side of the path. You've got some different colored trees now. We've got some sort of autumn looking colors here. We've got some new types of bushes here. This one I think is they're calling a beech bush right here. These ones I think are called creosote bushes. And I'm not sure what these ones are called here, but they're really, really cool looking. I love the colors. And then of course over here you've got your cactus for your desert theme. and back over here that might actually fit in with your scary woodsy trees back over there in the fantasy theme. You've got these dead trees you can fit in that same category, or you can just make them, you know, dried up and dead desert trees, because trees can't survive without water, right? So put those out in your desert, make it that much more realistic. And then finally, we have these wall climbers. There's several different options you have as far as placing ivy. These are the individual pieces, but if you put them all together, you can make it climb up a huge building. It looks really good on this brick pattern and the other stony patterns. And then you've also got these, let's see, what is this called? These are the, this is calling the building objects. Let's go into edit it so I can find out what that's actually called. This is the, it's going to be difficult on me. It's not letting me select it. There we go, floral creeper. I like this one just because of the fact that it's got these neat little, I don't know if they're purple flowers or if they're actually supposed to be grapes, but I love the color. It's definitely a nice contrast with the green, and it's something I really can't wait to use in my parks. So that's all we're going to cover for the scenery items, and we're going to go ahead and close this out. That covers all of these tabs in the middle here. The only other thing that I want to cover now is paths, terrain, and then the multi-select tool. The paths, really not much else has changed with the exception of one thing. And I'm going to go over here back to where I had these buildings that I created. The path textures are all the same. We don't have anything new added. We have the same natural paths as before, and we've got the same queue paths as before. The only difference that's been added, from what I can tell anyway, is that you're actually now able to place your paths on a selected grid of something else in your park. So say you don't want to do this freestyle building and you want it to be more precise to these particular buildings. If you go and you select the path that you want, you select the length and width that you want. I think, is 8 too large? Let's go down to, let's say, 5. No, let's go down all the way to the bottom. And then if you choose the select grid, you just select the item that you want the path to snap to. In this case, I want this building. And now, whenever I place the path to start with, it's going to place it on that particular grid for that particular building. And I can now build very specifically to that grid and even beyond it and around it. It's a little tricky. I have noticed that sometimes when you build sort of in an unnatural direction, it does get a little bit confused. But you guys get the idea that it actually does place it on this specific grid. So, like, see here, for some reason, after it passed that ATM, it's not working beyond that. I can't build anywhere around it. I'm not really sure why. But I can always just deselect the grid, and then I can go back to select grid again, and I can choose this one and go back and start building on this side. And sometimes if you do this and then maybe build here, and sometimes it'll let you connect, but I bet it's because this ATM is in the way that's giving me a hard time. But I can still build around the building like I did with the other one and be more precise with the path. And then, of course, probably come over here and connect it to the main path. But I'd have to probably deselect the grid to connect it that way. Again, it's a little tricky, but you guys get the idea that you can actually be a little bit more precise with your path placement in reference to specific buildings or even certain item building items. Okay, we're going to go ahead and close out the paths now. We're going to cover terrain. The terrain tools, as far as formation and deformation, they are the same. There's only one that's been added called Roughen, and I actually did use that tool to kind of create this area over here. I just used it in, like, you know, a lot in this area and then very little around this area. And all it does is it kind of, instead of pulling or pushing, it actually kind of pushes and pulls at the same time. It would actually help if I had that selected, wouldn't it? So you can see, instead of actually smoothing it out, it just makes things a little bit more rough, and it gives it more of sort of a natural look to it, because, you know, Mother Nature doesn't draw in straight lines, and she's often not very smooth. She's kind of rugged. So this actually gives you more of sort of like that earthen look, and makes it just that much more realistic. And of course, if you don't like how rough that looks, go back to your smoothing tool, increase the intensity, and just start smoothing it all out. There you go. It's not, you know, like the best. Well, I mean, I can't say it's not the best. It is a good tool in the arsenal of the sculpting tools that were already available. So you can see that I've just kind of created a little area here, you know, with that sculpting tool and all the sculpting tools available to me. As far as painting is concerned, there are actually some new textures based on the desert environment. We've got this one here, which is sort of like this deserty, rocky terrain here. I'm going to reduce the size here so I can show you guys and just continue it off right there. We've got this sort of desert sand here. This is actually sort of like a, I don't know, kind of clay-colored sand. We've got grass. It's not really a very lively grass, but in contrast to the sand, it is pretty cool. It's really interesting that there's such a glare on that when it's just supposed to be sand. Maybe it's a different type of rock. I'm not sure. Well, maybe it's because it's clay. That's why it's shiny. Who knows? We've got this sort of like beachy looking sand. This is more like for sand dunes. I bet you if you created some hills with this texture, it'd probably look like sand dunes. And then you've got the basic texture, which is pretty much the same as the texture that comes with the sand part or the sandbox that just overwrites everything and puts it back to the way it was. Finally, the only other thing to cover in this area is the water, and we all have been waiting a very, very, very long time for this. There's four different categories of water. There's calm water, there's rough water, standing water, and dirty water. I'm going to go ahead and show you guys all of them. I've already got some water selected for this particular little lake or pond. To get rid of it, you just right-click it, and then select which one you want. We'll start with the calm water, and then you see over here against the edge of your pond or lake or whatever, you've got these lines. Anywhere there's a blue line, you can actually add the water to. Over here is not a really good place. I found that actually if I add it over here, I can actually put more water in. So it's back to the level where I had it before. So that's what the calm water looks like. And I'm going to go ahead and actually just kind of do this where it's up against the sunset. And I'm going to hit play so you guys can actually see the animation on this and the reflections that are available. You can actually even see there's sort of like a water effect added here in the reflection of the sun. Super, super cool. Let's go ahead and show you the rough water right now. I'm not going to be able to get the height back, I think. Oh, that's good enough. This is one that I think I like even better because it's got sort of like these little wakes and waves that it creates. It gives it that much more life and animation to it, and I think I prefer that one over the calm. I also definitely prefer it over the standing water, which if you see here, it definitely fits for the desert environment. It contrasts better against the terrain, but I'm not really sure I dig the color. And you can see that even if you dive under, there's not a lot of underwater animation. It's just sort of like a little level of water here, and that's fine because you're mostly gonna be looking at it from above anyway. But it still looks really, really awesome. And then finally, we have the dirty water, which I honestly don't know what I'd use this for, but ew. I mean, they don't kid around. It is dirty. So I'm gonna go back to the rough water because that is my favorite, and I don't want to see anything else but that. So that's everything in the terrain tool, guys. Oh, and you know, I'm actually now that I look over here, I forgot something in the scenery items that is very, very important. We have new special effects. Before we had categories such as fire, electricity, we had some water and smoke, but now we've got some new water effects primarily that have been added, mainly in regards to splashes. And again, you have your categories and subcategories over here, so I'm gonna choose the water. And these ones right here are what I have currently selected in this park, and they are called, see, this one's called a water splash line. There's three different sizes. You have a water splash ring, large and small. And then my favorite so far is the mist. And that's what these ones are right here. I really wish I would have placed it on a different type of terrain. In fact, actually, let's go ahead and do that. Let's go back to the terrain. Let's paint this a green texture because you might actually be able to see it a little bit better because this effect is really, really, really cool. That mist, it looks like it's kind of static at first. When you get down and take a look, it actually is moving and it's hovering and it's floating and it's very, very realistic. And you don't have to have it, the panel above ground like that. You can just click it and go to the advanced move section and sync it below the ground and then hit OK. And this actually is still showing the mist above the ground. So you can see that that's probably going to make for some really cool effects. Like if you had a spooky woods and you want to lay some of those underneath the terrain and have sort of like a low-lying fog everywhere, I mean, how cool would that be to have your peeps walking through that? There's a large size, there's a medium size, and a small size. And with the water rings over here, the water splash rings, I'll show you something that you can do that I've actually created over in this area. It's really cool. You guys have seen before that they actually have this animated cannon in the pirate theme area that shoots the cannon out like that. You know, it's kind of intermittent. Well, actually, it's a fairly even interval. But it's got a neat little animation. But what happens when you actually add this, point it to a lake and you actually add the water splashes, watch this. Boom. It's kind of hard to time them, but you guys get an idea that if you just sort of do this right here and then have the water splashes over there in the distance, it actually makes it look like there's a cannonball splashing down in the water over there. So I really think that those are going to be used quite frequently and very often, well, in situations like this and maybe even others that I haven't thought of. I can't wait to see what people create. One other thing that I wanted to comment on, guys, I've seen some people on YouTube videos about the water in Planet Coaster here say that it just does not look realistic. And I want to take a moment here. I'm going to pause this, and I'm going to have you take a look at this water right now as it is. I have a decent graphics card. It's not the highest end, but I mean, take a look at the reflection and unpause it, the animation of this water. Tell me that does not look incredible. Tell me that when Roller Coaster Tycoon World first came out and had that ugly looking blue goo in there, that this didn't look 10 times better than it did on its initial day. I mean, this is beautiful. I'm not sure why there was so much negativity surrounding the water, but I'm absolutely in love with it. Even when you choose the dirty stuff, it actually has the similar reflections, and I think it's just beautiful. You should see it when the sun is setting or rising too. Those reflections look even better. So that pretty much covers the terrain. There's only one other thing that I want to show you guys, and that is the multi-select tool. It is exactly what it says. If you want to select more than one item, you can actually do that now with this tool. Just go ahead and select the control click to add or remove. I'm not sure why it says control click. Probably just like hold down the control key and then select things multiply. You can do it that way, or you can also click and drag a marquee around the items you want to select, and it'll actually select the items that you had within that box. Select more items in a bigger box, and you can actually get an idea of the number of scenery items in this little window that you either can save as a selection, as a blueprint. This is actually how you would create scenery blueprints. You could move it, you could do the advanced move, or if you just click this button, they all go bye-bye. Now, you guys notice I actually had this area selected over here where the path and the path objects were. Those do not get deleted. They are one of the exceptions to the rule. The other exception to the rule are rides, like roller coasters and flat rides. So if I come over here and I do a multi-select, I am not able to delete, I'm not able to move or anything like that. Those ones you have to do individually, unfortunately. So if you do have like a big area of scenery though that you want to clean out, that is the best way to do it. Like say I just want to clean out here and I want to start from scratch, select them all and delete it. Boom, gone. Piece of cake. I won't miss those ones there. Goodbye. Adios. It's a really nice way to clear out a large section if you really need to. I'm not sure why you need to do that yet. I haven't had a need to, but you get the idea now. So that is all I have for this video, guys. Thanks so much for hanging in there and paying attention to everything that I had to say. I'm thrilled about this game, and I can't believe that we are still in alpha. There's a beta to come out still and the full release. What more could they add to this? I mean, seriously, what more awesomeness could they add to the pile of awesomenessity for this game? I mean, it is so cool. I really appreciate everybody's support. I know it's been a while. Now that I've actually covered all the new stuff, I do intend to actually get a park going, post some videos of some rides, maybe even doing some new tutorials here and there. But I definitely wanted to get this out before I did any of those. So thanks again, guys, for watching. If you really like this video, or if there's something that I did not cover in this video and you want to comment down below, please do so. If you have a question about something that I didn't cover and you want me to try to figure it out for you, put it down there. I will do my darndest to look in the forums and play on the game until I can figure it out and help you out the best that I can. Click like if you did like this video, and if you haven't already done so, hit that little subscribe button. It helps me out a lot. Appreciate all the fans out there that enjoyed this, and until the next video, happy building and keep it loopy.